motion. With the changes, yeah. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, public comment? No? Yay. Old business, I would say the grass is starting to look pretty good.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like super wet out.
There is another update on Capitol because of the, you know, as you guys made a motion last, passed a motion last full board meeting to increase the budget so we can afford the shelving. My understanding is that will be, that will go through city council on the 20th.
Okay.
And so, and I, you know, I think we're gonna cut that down, but they're also going, their plan is to approve carpeting also at the same meeting.
So they're gonna paint the carpeting, huh?
Correct.
Okay.
Back to your written communication from the public, we could get some spam email, just so you know, like it's not real, the Decatur, we won an award for.
From the Decatur, the Decatur Award Department?
Award Department, something.
I didn't get it.
Okay. Well, I know Carl got it, I think somebody else got it, so I just wanted to at least say, like.
Oh, no, no, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Just FYI, I learned yesterday at Director's University, I'm not a student, but I still learn things. Tidbit that, you know, oftentimes when I send you guys all an email, I say, reply just to me. Because if you reply all, you're violating the Open Meetings Act. Sometimes people forget, you know, it's just automatically, reply all.
I love.
I'm BCCing you guys, I'm just putting you all on the BCC line and you can't.
That's smart.
You can't use reply all, so we're good.
Got it.
Nice.
Yes.
That's a good one. Okay, I think that's it, right? Oh, we have to go to the check register. So the Illinois Library Association says other library grant expense, what does that mean?
What page?
First page. $1,095.06. And I understand the local zoo want that. Oh, is that just an expense?
Yeah, we purchase IRE program from the Illinois Library Association. That's basically our theme and all the, you know, t-shirts and things like that and some surprises. So we purchase those from the Illinois Library Association. Other library grant expense is the budget line that it's on, and that means that it was paid for with grant funds. So we paid for it with the friends. Friends paid for it.
Yeah. That's the one grant kind of specific to the children's department? Or is it just a normal, I think there's.
Every grant that's not the per capita grant on that line. So anything, any grant expenditure, so we've got a corresponding line, revenue line for that too. So when we get the monies, we put them in the revenue line and we expend them, we put them on other library grant expenses. Mostly that's things from the friends, but sometimes the foundation, sometimes other granting bodies.
So what is the, it says the Midwest AV and streaming services, but it says office supplies, but AV and streaming services?
Yeah, so this is a, it's, and we probably, you and I need to look at this because what we're seeing, you're not, sometimes one check covers an invoice that has things that are on more than one budget line. So it might be, it might be office supplies because they do some processing for us. So in other words, they send us the books or the tapes or whatever. The DVDs or whatever already with, we do the barcoding, but they've got all the other stickers on them, the classification stickers and the,
Okay. And
so some of the bulk of that, it's a split invoice. In other words, invoices on more than one budget line. We pay it with the same check, but for accounting purposes, I hope I'm making, I'm not sure if I'm making it clear. But it's not displaying correctly. So if you've got the original Excel spreadsheet that she does this on, you can see the dropdown.
So this is a line item on one invoice, and the header is office supply.
Yeah, sometimes, but what it's not displaying, sometimes there's more than one.
That's what I'm saying. I mean, this AV streaming service, that's a line item.
Correct.
Header on the invoice is Office Supply.
Correct.
And then I have a question, it says peerless networking and it's telephone.
Yep, that's our long distance, I believe.
So that's a lot of long distance.
They've changed, they might be our local. P-Tech is, no, P-Tech is long distance. Peerless is the landline service.
So are we happy like with PatronPoint?
Yeah, we're very happy. We're very happy with PatronPoint and we may actually expand its use. We found that, so it's mostly our, what we use it for now is for our more than one, several newsletters, our newsletter service. But we're beginning to look at, they'll do ID verification. So they can simplify the process of getting a card for us. I'm talking to a couple other directors that are using it who really like it. I have a few concerns still, but I respect, there's two directors to talk to I respect a lot. And you know, and it's just a couple more $1,000 a year. And the patient will be able to input their information themselves. All we're going to need to do is see their training.
Yeah, and I mean, I know that's been kind of a hassle in the past.
And then we can look at things like, let's stop just having one place to get a card, one spot in the library.
Yes.
Sending people, you know, going one place, someplace else to get a card, so.
And I did have a question on the hotspots. I see there's some hotspots.
So here's, we bought those from TechSoup in order to cancel the ones that are costing us a fortune.
Okay. Well, because I did have somebody who is a patron, she's like, I've been on the list for a while and I'm going on vacation this weekend. So it sounds like there is a waiting list, so I wasn't sure.
Well, Carol, last time I talked, Carol said that she thought we were at pretty much the right amount right now. What she said was there was never enough on the shelf, but you know, the waiting list was pretty short. So, but how long did your friend say she's been on the waiting list?
I mean, maybe it was, I don't know when she put it in.
I can read this.
She was, well, and I'm just thinking like people are going on vacation, so like in the summer, so if we can, you know.
Well, we don't have to cancel the others, you know.
Well, yeah,
right.
I'm,
right. Right. Are we checking these
out? Yes. I'm just going to play devil's advocate for a second. Is this usually when you go on vacation? First of all, you can afford to go on vacation.
Well, yeah.
Second of all, they have Wi-Fi wherever you go. And
it's crappy in
the
hotel.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, and I'm okay with people using it for vacation, but I originally, like, the whole thing was we wanted to have it because
access.
Everything was shutting down, the world was shutting down, people can't afford anything. And I'm not saying your friend doesn't deserve it, I'm just saying that I'm not sure we need to beef up for vacations.
I mean, yeah. I mean, but it is what our patrons are looking for, you know. It is, they're also our patrons as well. So.
Yeah,
I agree.
Too, we wouldn't really know what they're using it for.
Yeah.
I mean, they check it out. We don't put on, say, okay, why do you say it's
hard? Yeah, that's right. And we've got there. I see your point. I used to say the same thing about, you know, how long people were on the computers. You know, like, she might argue that they should be on there longer. And I'm like, yeah, but man, they're just sitting there on Facebook. It's not up to us to decide what the property, you know, the best use is. I totally get what you're saying. You know,
I just don't think we need to necessarily think about like vacation season. Let's up our amount.
Right.
Was my point.
And extra time on the computer doesn't cost us any money.
No.
Whereas the hotspots do.
And I would say as long as there's computers open, then extra time is fine. But
and that's what we just that's what we just said. So what, you know, our intent was not to beef it up. Our intent is to, we've got some that are much more expensive. Our intent was to cancel those.
Yeah, no, I was curious because we talked about it.
But see, TechSoup is set up for government and not-for-profits, where we bought it from, where we got these from, and they have a limit on how many we can get. But we can get them every couple of years, so we're going to keep doing it.
So we don't limit how long people can have the hotspot?
We do. Yeah, we do. off the top of my head, I think it's a month.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a month, and what happens is if they don't bring it back, this, the equipment doesn't cost us anything, it's a service.
It's a service.
Right, so all we do is turn it off.
Turn it off.
Yeah.
And does Tech Suit charges if we say, okay, we need an additional device, say we never get that device back?
I don't know. I don't know what Tech Suit, but I know that Verizon did not. So there was no charge for the device, and I don't think this is for the device either. I think this is, it's actually just for a month.
And that's what I'm saying. So say we turn it off, someone says, oh, it doesn't work, those are trash. We go from 11 to 10.
It doesn't cost us anything.
To get one back, to get another for them to send us?
I know it didn't for Verizon. It didn't cost anything or anything. I'm sure all we have to do is, you know,
say
anything.
They're making so much money on
those things. Yeah. They're tiny little devices that don't cost, you know, manufacturing of them doesn't cost much money. It's, you're paying for the data. Yeah, I've used it for vacation.
I'm okay with it. I'm just saying. I don't care what people use it for. I just don't know if we need to spend more money on
vacation. And I pulled up the Heritage Quest so you guys can take a look at what we're paying for that. It's not getting as much use as it was, but it does still get. It's a genealogy site, and it's only in-house. It's only in-house, you gotta do it in the building. It's a lot more if we make it and accessible from home.
Yeah, I went back to like 1800.
Really?
Very cool. I wanted to point out an error on on the last page of the check register for FixStat, My Libro. So My Libro is the software, there's a lot of things that Patriots can do with it. But most of them have been superseded by our new app that we got from our consortium. Uh-huh. Except, at least for now, curbside pickup requests. Mm-hmm. So we can do that on the new app, but it's going to take some work, and we don't know how long it's going to take. So what is incorrect on this is it says June 22 to May 23. It's June 22 to December 23. This is a half a year. I just thought, for that price, I'm going to go ahead and extend it for a little while and give us time to work on it. So our app, and as of July 1, you'll be able to check out books with your phone.
Okay, so June 22 through December 23, so that's a year and a half?
Mm-hmm. Excuse me, December 22.
22, okay.
Yeah, it's 6 months.
Okay, I thought that's what you meant.
Yeah. So.
But I think we need to solve the problem. We need to figure out how to get everybody aligned to this plan.
Yeah, that can be manipulated.
So that it's more clear. Of what we budgeted already by the end of May. So as far as the expenses go, we're a little ahead of ourselves on materials, but we have complete control over that. When we run the money, we stop buying. So that's nothing to worry about. Professional services, that's a little misleading. We're at 15%, but we haven't gotten that second invoice from Gaeta Jones yet. That'll be $45,000.
So how is that progressing?
We will be having the first meeting for a strategy Wednesday. So they've gotten the insights report that I shared with you guys. Now it's just an information gathering, and they're going to start working on strategy as of Wednesday. So I'm hoping that we're going to get some more concrete suggestions at that time, because the suggestions we have right now are, to me, kind of abstract. Things like, recenter the employees in this policy. That to me isn't very
fine. Find the center.
Yes. So we're overall
exactly.
Our expenses are at so our operating expenses, that's not personnel, are at 38% roughly. And when we get to the projection, I've got some more stuff to say. But our overall cash, Cantone, you guys asked me to start the process,
yeah.
The legal process of allowing us to spend this money. Chris, our attorney, did the filing yesterday.
Okay.
So he doesn't expect there will be any pushback, but he's ready if there is. Our overall cash position at the end of May is $1.4 million. So, that's pretty good.
Yeah. Doing a good job, right?
As you do.
Only in the world.
Sure. Yeah.
Okay, so the next thing we need to talk about is the off duty.
Oh, well, there's the projection. Under revenue, it's PPRT that is, way ahead. So right now, I'm projecting a total, we budgeted $500,000. I'm projecting that we'll collect double that based on the current rate we're getting. Overall, all the revenue looks pretty good. The one expense line that's bad, medical insurance, again, we're on a pace to exceed what is budgeted by $100,000. I'm hoping that will settle down. I'm hoping that the clinic will save us money, as Greg and Mr. Reckman, City Manager Reckman, City Treasurer Tintera, I believe that it will. And I'm kind of being an evangelist for it, because there's no out-of-pocket cost to the patient, so no reason not to do it. That's the only expense line that's worrisome. We're really in a good place financially, so.
Well, I mean, the nice thing is that we're getting extra money from the PPRT, so.
We've already got over 600,000, like 670, 680,000 in PPRT.
Okay.
And we budgeted 500 and some thousand.
That's crazy. Okay, awesome.
I wanted to budget a little more than that. Greg told me, no, we're going to do this, but I wasn't anywhere close to what it is either. I mean, my estimation was much lower than this. So. So I met with Mike Pritchett, who is the assistant manager of the Civic Center, and he's the one who contracts with the off-duty police officers for the Civic Center and for the bus depot over here. He's is also our building. He said the cost, he said they're not, I don't know how much I told you about this.
Well, you and I talked about it, but I don't think we all.
So. So,
Doc, I'm not you guys around.
He said it's not just, I told you guys it's just county, he said it's both county and city. It's $32 an hour, now that's $3 an hour more than Securitas. Securitas is roughly $29 now. He said it'd take about 30 days, he believes, to get somebody, it'd probably be more than, if you do 40 hours a week, it'd probably be more than one officer, to get somebody trained. He said he's never had any trouble, having a sergeant be responsive if he didn't like something that, you know, the police officer was doing, and he said he's rarely had any trouble. He said they don't just sit, they walk around the building. To me, that's key, you know, show your presence. And there's still a possibility, they need to get with Deputy City Manager Kinsley again, but there's still a possibility that the grant monies for violence prevention that came from Senator Turner, through the Chief of Staff is on our board, Mr. Coleman, that might go get paid for through that grant.
That'd be awesome.
So, the cons are, you know, the pros are that they got a gun, the cons are that they got a gun. You know, I think that's both a good thing and a bad thing in some ways. I did look at the metal detector, really not expensive. You can get one for about $3,000. My question is that it doesn't have to be staffed.
No, yeah, you just said it, forget it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, but what are you going to do if you get a...
If you couple it with security, then they can, you know...
Right, but wouldn't they have to be there?
I mean, you could get it to where it will send an alert. I mean, even if it's at the point to where the people at the desk hear go off, they can radio, because security would have to have some central point of communication, like everybody. So, like, up here, this
sure,
bullpen would have a radio to security downstairs. So anytime they hear to say, hey, we had a metal detector go off here, person walked by, they're wearing clothes A, B, and C, they look like this, and security can go.
It doesn't snap picture.
Well, I mean, let me do some more homework on it then to see, you know, is it going to pick up everything? Is it going to be my keys? Is it going to be, you know?
They make it to wear stuff. I mean, it's adjustable.
So the cost isn't much. Yeah. I mean, honestly, the sunken cost is pretty low. Unless what I was looking at was a bare bones version. But I mean, I saw them less than that. But the middle price seems to be $3,000-ish.
You can get somebody there with a wand.
Yeah.
That would just be.
But it's weird. They've got the, you know, I've been at the state library the last couple of days, and they've got it all in the state library, but nobody's made it go through. I mean, it's there.
Yeah.
You got a security guy sitting there, you got a desk.
Yeah. Well, you got to install it at the door. That's the thing. Like, if you install it away from the door, and you allow people an option to go around it. And there's caveats. Like, some people say, well, I got electronic devices in my body. I got a trigger. I'm a trigger, and I'm set it off. There's nuisance trips. Some people say, man. Now that's one of the problems we get the cheaper ones, because they go defective and you end up having to turn it off so that it's not working and you just have a $3,000.
I'm gonna dive deeper and get some more details and maybe even give you guys a couple of quotes.
Well, here's another question. I mean, if this is something that we're considering doing, wouldn't these people know about it?
They very, very possibly would. Yeah, and a private security firm may actually sell that, you know, as a one-time cost, you know. You could look at it's, you know, secure. I'm sure Securitas might
have. Securitas had a whole bunch of that package. They had drones. Yes, they could use
that. Yes.
Robot dogs running around.
You guys can just borrow my dog. She'll run around here.
Well, they have dogs that sniff out COVID, so, yeah.
wouldn't sure bark at everybody, but he wouldn't scream.
Yeah, neither would I. Mine likes to bark at people, but it's only because she wants to.
So.
She's going to go high, she's like, what?
Anyway, that's the you know, they can detain, unlike Securitas.
Yeah.
You know, we've got a, you know, there's the question of, you know, community police relations, which could be better. And our, as I said, our deputy city manager feels this, like, this is an opportunity to improve that. While that's great, well, that's a great thing, that's not my goal here. My goal is to keep us safe.
Yeah. Does the staff have any feelings on it?
I think you're gonna see it split about right down the middle. Yeah, there's some who you know, I think if we talk to our social worker, Jess, she said private security would be something that she thinks would be better, less. Some of the homeless population here may have had some bad experiences with police officers over the years. Whereas other people are like, what good is a security person with no training and no gun can do? But
well,
you know, parents of Uvalde that they might have even a third.
I mean, my question is correctness, right? Do the police, would they be willing to operate under parameters? Like, listen, you're just here to do A, B, and C. We don't need extra policing, just, you know, secure the perimeter.
Here's our policies.
Right. And then that's it, because you don't want it to turn into a police beat. And
right.
then it's just, you know, hey, we're on the job, and this is a police beat, versus we just need you here to keep the patron safe.
That was my question. That was my question. And Mike Pritchett, who he thinks that they're pretty responsive in that you can train the way you want to train.
The police?
I felt same.
Have you not seen the Blue Lives Matter movement?
Yeah,
defund the police?
I
don't think that's going to be. They had the blue line on the police car. Yeah, it lets you know when they stand on police sensitivity training.
Right.
But I mean, I could be wrong. I don't know. Maybe the blue line means different, and they just have a different perspective of it. I don't know.
One of the things that I prefer about private is they're going to answer to us.
Right.
Well, it's like they have. They're cheaper by $4 an hour, but like that's not the biggest issue. But like they have a lot more like functionality. They have like the sensitivity training that you mentioned, like specifically like how to deal with our specific patron base. You know, like some of our
de-escalation.
Yeah, we see that with the police who respond to calls. We see that we had an officer in, we had one of those weird incidents where we had two people who were clearly having a mental health episode at the same time. They're 15 feet away from each other. Not interacting with each other at all. There's just two people who happen to be having an episode at the same time.
Yeah.
Or, you know, one of them begins to make threats to the person next to her at a computer, so we call the police, and the other one has to leave, and she won't leave. We call the police. He gets here. He wasn't even asking. He got him out of here, but did so without putting his hands on anybody. He listened. He talked him down. He got de-escalated. Other officers, not so much.
Well, so that was a question that I should have asked when we had the young woman online. How do they handle incidents? Like, what is say there's a guy that has an eye. How do they handle it? How do they get the situation de-escalated and the person removed? Like, how does that play out? Are they just, well, hey, you just stand back with you and call the police? Like,
that's my, you know, if it's an actual violence or threat of violence, they're going to be calling the police likely.
Yeah. But that's what I'm saying. I mean, so how do they keep the patrons safe? That's what I'm saying. I mean, I can call the police. Right? But I'm saying I could call the police. You know, I mean, that's kind of back into the pro and cons deal. Like the police, it's more all in one. Like you don't have to worry about anything.
And you don't have to wait. Like you don't have to wait for them to get here.
You know, and I when we're depending on the situation, if it's we call a non-emergency number, they're going to take the time to get here. When we've got an actual incident, their response time has been very good. But it's still.
Yeah, but that's the thing. So if somebody has a knife and they said, I'm going to cut you, I'm going to cut that person, I'm going to cut that person, 30 seconds is a long time.
It sure is.
Yep. You know what I mean? So. Yeah, no, go ahead.
So
jump in.
Request, sounds like an appropriate request. Anybody can request it, and we're so understanding. understaffed, I doubt it's ever going to happen, and it's already happened a few times. So.
Are they understaffed? The police are understaffed?
That's what it's like.
Nobody wants to work. What is it about?
They don't have enough people applying.
Nobody wants to be a police.
I'm sure there's, yeah, there's.
Police force?
Yes, and they're not giving them. I do it, but I'm not qualified.
What? They make you qualified.
I wouldn't do it.
There is an age requirement.
Is it really?
Yeah, I'm too old, but I do it.
To do what? Shoot somebody? You never be too old to shoot somebody.
I don't like the gun thing. I don't like guns.
They have tasers.
I don't want any of my guns.
The gun's just for show though. You wouldn't even.
I've never shot a gun. I don't play on.
My mom taught me how to shoot.
This is an issue that is financial, but it's also policy, you know. But, you know, if you guys want to have a recommended action for the full board.
I feel like we need to talk about it as a full board. I feel like it's too important and I don't think we can make a.
I don't think the three of us, I mean, we can have our.
I'll see if I can get more.
Do you have feelings?
No.
I'll see if I can get more details from Mike.
No feelings.
I don't. I'll see if I can get more details from Mike before the board meeting, full board meeting this week.
I mean, now, the feelings I do have is I would really like to kind of get some definitive answer because it seems like.
We need to just do.
There's no slowing down on the incidents, right? I mean, you had an assault, you found a knife.
Second knife.
You know what I mean? A second knife. The gentleman was just having a, you know what I mean?
I have to admit that I was, you know, I was blundering. They were overreacting in the last few weeks.
Right.
You said David.
And the summertime, only the heat makes it worse.
Yeah.
It's the hotter it is, the more uncomfortable and agitated people get.
No, the worst time for the hospital is every time it gets warm out, like right from cold to warm. Mm-hmm. That's when everybody's out shooting each other. I was noticing. Like a
was the agreement. Listen, you eat my baby and we eat your baby.
What?
Yes, it was an agreement.
He wasn't gonna eat the baby.
No. So the agreement was it was a famine. It was a famine. They made an agreement. We'll eat my baby first, and then we'll. No, I'm telling you.
You're Solomon. You're something else, but it's true. They're okay. Both correct, but they're separate stories.
I thought you were Solomon, the Bible.
Yeah.
Yes. Wait,
you're talking about eating the baby.
Well,
that did happen.
That did happen.
That did happen.
I don't know the story.
Solomon has cut the baby in the half, and the real mom won't allow it to
happen. Yeah, that's what it was, right? The lady was like, she took my baby. And I was like, no, it's my baby. That's what it was. But it was one. I think that was in Judges, though.
It's in the Old Testament, though.
Yeah, it was in Judges.
Okay, well, I don't remember that.
Well, let's
table
this. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
People watching this are going to be like, what is happening?
Matt's going to have a good time in the morning.
Global history control system.
So, about 8 years ago, I sat in this room with some engineers.
Good old MEs.
And Jim Alpe, who was the president of the board at the time. Jim was also an architect and head of public housing at the time. And I didn't know what they were talking about. But Jim said this isn't going to work. So they designed a control system, well, just a mechanical system for the new local history room. So in local history, unlike the rest of the building, it's very important to keep the environmental conditions stable. You don't want big swings in temperature or especially humidity. You can go range of about 20%, but you don't want it to get outside of that range.
Right.
Because over time, that degrades the paper. We were told that this would work. It works a little bit less well every year, and so I asked the city of Decatur, you guys own the building, you want to fix this? And they said, this is a design flaw, and if you look at the contract, it says that they're responsible for to maintain things as designed.
Mm.
Okay, so we did not build the local history room. Public funds. We did the foundation. So I won't be asking the foundation to pay for this, but I thought just in case they don't. I don't know whether it's a good idea to pre-approve because then the foundation may say,
well, you guys already agreed to pay for it.
But all I'm saying is this is, they've been holding this park for us now for a couple of months, and the foundation's going to meet this third week of June, I think. We're trying to get the president to set a date. But the problem was the control system they installed is a residential control system. It's a split unit, so it's not on the boiler and the chiller that the rest of the library is on. It's on a split unit that's up on the roof. But the control system is inadequate. And humidity has been out of control, and we've got dehumidifiers in there running to try to get it under control, and that's okay in the short term, but it's not going to be a good long-term solution. So anyway, this is the quote we got from Cloud Controls to replace the existing control system, and I don't know what the foundation's going to say, but I think that they did build the room, they paid to build the room. Our understanding is it's a design flaw. And I remember 8 years ago sitting in this room with our former trustee president telling them this is not going to work.
And is he still around?
He's in Kansas City.
Okay, let him know he's right.
Yeah, I surprise you guys if the foundation says no.
Yep.
We don't have a choice. It's
yeah.
Well, I think we table until you talk to the foundation then.
Right.
And the foundation
is their court first.
It should be a meeting too.
Yeah, not next week, but the week after, I think it is.
thought it was the judges, but it was in King.
I mean, we can't.
I don't know how those.
Yeah, it does.
I mean, other than high school.
Yeah, it is. That's the last one.
I haven't been in high school for a long time.
You just got.
6 or 7 years.
5 years.
Well, technically 35.
All right, thanks.
Okay.
So I do have a question. Workforce, this on other. Has any work been done on the workforce?
The bid went out, but I don't think they've hired a contractor yet.
Okay. Good job.
So I apologize to you guys about the mess that I made on the holiday. I sent you some emails today. You guys voted to have us close at noon on election day, which I got, but also primary day, which is June 28th. Well, she put that in front of me to sign, and I said, this is wrong. I fixed it. And she was right, and I was wrong. And so, I realized that today. Here's the problem, is we've already scheduled some stuff for that afternoon. So we're going to have to remain open. And since you guys voted to do that, my suggestion is going to be, we can't vote on it today because of the, is to just give people some additional holiday time that they can either use that day to go vote or whatever, or they can bank it. I did have election day on there. We'll have to decide how much holiday time they're going to get for election day, because some people work 9 to 5 or 8 to 5, some people work 11 to 8. If we're closing at noon, because the union was on before I walked out the door. Literally, we sent it out at 11:45, and then noon, they're like, we need to talk. So we've got to decide how much time. Are they going to get a full day?
I think they attention what's happening, regardless.
Right. So here's the situation. So if I'm scheduled to work 11 to 8 that day, I come in, I work 11 to noon, and I get a pay, and I get a half day, so I get paid for 5 hours.
Well, it's half a day. So I mean, if you're
full time, you're a full timer, then I got to work an 11-hour day, so one day to make up for it,
I don't understand. So if they're 11 to 8, that's 9 hours.
Right. We close at noon. They're coming in and working 11 to
11. Well, I thought it was half a day. I didn't know we were closing at noon. I thought people were working half a day.
That's what it was voted for. That's where it gets.
So the library is working half a day.
Library is closing less than half a day.
What I'm saying is, what time does the library close? That's what I'm saying. So if it's noon, then the library is working closing at noon.
Yeah. I can't change it now. We approved it.
Yeah. Yeah, but all we have to decide is how we're going to allocate the paid time off. So I'll be coming in working 4 hours, because I work 8 to noon.
If somebody else comes in working 1 hour.
That doesn't matter to me, I'm salaried anyway, but somebody else coming is going to work 11 to noon.
Well, can we have everybody come in earlier? I mean, there's got to be enough jobs.
But you said the problem is with June, it's already been scheduled.
Well, June's off the
week. Yeah,
June.
Okay.
This is for November.
November, I know you said some people come in later, but if we're closing at noon.
We probably could mess with
that. Was my plan.
We probably could monkey with the schedule and make everybody get a half day.
There you go.
I think
that would be the best way to do it.
Yeah. All right, and we'll be in close June 20th for Juneteenth.